What up, you guys? How y'all doing? I have returned for my recap video of the Philadelphia Supercross, the first time we raced there since 1980. And, oh man, did we have an action-packed day race. And I gotta say, after what I saw, we could very well be looking at two potential champs, one wrapping up the title, maybe one race early, if things work out. But I think this is still going to go down to the wire. First of all, guys, subscribe and help the algorithm. I want to keep my monetization status on my main channel. And the only way I can do that is with your help. I'm going to put up my banner here. So let's get into this. Okay, now I'm going to start with the 250 class first. And as you can see here, Tom Vial could win the 250 East title. And I say that because when Tom Vial had kind of like one of the most, when Tom Vial had his ride, he had kind of one of the most quietest rides for a second place finish, at least in my opinion, because the way that everyone was riding, Seth Hamaker got out front Philly zone or Pennsylvania zone. Seth Hamaker was out front. And it looked like that he was on his way to winning Pro Circuit, their 300th race, 300th career race. But I got to say, Seth Hamaker is the guy that I feel so, so terrible for, especially after what happened, especially after what Jalik Swole did to him. Now, am I saying that was anybody's fault? Not really, but I'll talk about that in a little bit. To finish up my point on Tom Vial, Tom Vial had kind of one of the most quietest second-place rides, in my opinion, because he didn't really fight for the lead until pretty much late in the race. And then when the pack started bunching up, and Tom Vial was one of those guys, he was the guy who pretty much evaded all mistakes outside of Hayden Deegan. And especially when Pierce Brown cross-rutted off the finish line jump. And that really made me scratch my head there to how that came to be. But then again, that track was really soft. I don't think the weather played any part into that. I think it was just how soft the soil really was. And fortunately, it looked like that Pierce Brown was okay. He ended up 14th for the night, but still, I was scratching my head at how that came to be, especially with the cross running. But fortunately, Tom Vial evaded all mistakes and ended up finishing second behind race winner Max Anstey. And I felt so great for Anstey, and good on him too, because that was a win that was certainly needed, especially after at one point in the season, Anstey was your points leader, despite not having the best finishes. And I had pointed out in a past video, that reminded me of 1998 in the 250 class at the time, when it was the premier class, when Jeremy McGrath was the points leader after Indianapolis, and he was 45 points up on Jeff Emig. And after Emig had gone second, third, and fourth in the first three races, he went 14-8-7 in the next three and still found himself second in the series. And that was all combined by a bunch of bad luck from other guys like Ezra Lusk and to a point Kevin Windham and Doug Henry. But still, for Anstey to come through with that win, oh man, that was so good on him. That had to have been the most feel-good story of the night. And if Seth Hamaker had won, oh my God, I think the Philly crowd would have just been absolutely electric. Okay. Because it's one thing to win a race in 2 years, to win your first race in 2 years. Because last time Hamaker won was 2021. I believe it was in Dallas. In one of the three races there. Or actually, yeah, Seth took a couple of those wins. Actually, Seth took two of those wins there. But still, for Hamaker to win that race, that would have been so, so special. And it wasn't that long ago that when Dean Wilson won his first career 250 race in Atlanta in 2011, that was win number 200 for the Pro Circuit Kawasaki team. Going back to the peak days, or the, you know, back in the 90s with guys like McGrath, Swink, Jeremy Buell, and Mike Brown. That seems filled with history, and I would have certainly loved to see Hamaker win that race. But still, I think it was safe to say that we had a different winner lined up for the season, regardless of what happened. And fortunately, we did have that outcome with Max Anstey winning. But still, if I'm Seth Hamaker right now, yeah, I would feel pretty ticked off that that win got away from him. And of course, he was coming off of that shoulder injury. And I have to say that when he held off Hayden Deegan for the heat race win, I kind of had a feeling that if he got the good start, he was going to bring it home gate to flag, because even with that shoulder injury, because he missed the last race at Nashville. And I kind of thought that if he held off Deegan for the heat race win, who's to think that he's going to hold off Max Anstey for the main event win? Unfortunately, it didn't work out. And Hamaker isn't really easy to pass. He kind of reminds me of Mike Craig in a sense, because Craig was not easy to pass, and you really had to think of everything to pass him. But fortunately, for Anstey anyway, he found a way around Seth Hamaker, and it was all looking good for Hamaker, and I thought he was going to make the podium if it wasn't for Jalik Swole. Now, I got to say that when Swole went for that pass on Hamaker, I thought it was a bit of a risky move, and it was so ill-advised. But the problem for Swole was I don't think he even realized it at all, but Hamaker went fast enough to be able to go to the outside and keep his line. I don't think Swole even saw that, like I said. And by the time he did, or if he did, it was way too late. You don't make that pass on someone unless you've got damn good nerves of steel. I mean, Ricky Carmichael did that to Sebastian Tortelli at Bud's Creek in 2000. But the difference there was that Carmichael's was a little bit more calculated, and he had nerves of steel then. Swole just kind of went for it. And while I respect Jalik for going for it, it was not a very wise move, really. I mean, Hamaker, after that, he was all right with it. It is a racing incident, and I agree. It was a racing incident for sure. But still, I just don't think Swole realized that Hamaker had gone fast enough to be able to keep his line had he just decided to power through it. But I think that Hamaker got spooked by Swole's presence there. And I got to say that if Hamaker had just powered through it, he probably could have avoided Swole maybe by just a fraction of an inch. I don't know. You be the judge of that. But still, for Tom Vial to possibly win this title, good on Tom Vial, because, you know, he is proving himself to be that guy, that some of us kind of expected, maybe even Tom Vial himself. Because if he wins this title, he gets a year to defend it. Then he's up to the 450 class. But I think a lot of us kind of thought it was a done deal when McAdoo seized control. And after Cameron crashed with Gage Linwood in practice at Nashville, I think that kind of kicked the door wide open. And Tom Vial took advantage of that and regained the points lead. Now, for Tom Vial, it wasn't a winning ride, but still, it was a great ride for him to get the points lead back. And something tells me that with one race to go, with that being the East-West shootout or showdown, as people are calling it, still, all Vial really needs to do is stay near Hayden Deegan. But, of course, anything can happen. We saw what happened to Donnie Hansen when he won the motocross title in 1982. Over Rick Johnson, who did a huge jump at Denver, broke a wheel, lost the title, and coughed up a 12-point lead. And we saw what happened to Ryan Villopoto in 2007 in the 250 class at Unadilla. He had built a 20-point lead, then a rock pierced his radiator, and he was out for the first moto. And he saw his 20-point lead go up in flames. And fortunately, Villopoto came back to win the title. So, you know, anything can happen, but really, the reality is, all Vial really needs to do is finish near Hayden Deegan in the showdown. And we go back to the West on Denver. So we'll see what happens then. And hopefully Levi Kitchen can deliver Pro Circuit their first title in 7 years. Okay, now for the 450 class. As you can see on my banner here, Jet Lawrence regains control. Jet Lawrence, he put all his eggs in one basket, and that was a good thing this time. Because that was a track, that track at Philly, that was a track where passing was, where you had to really get creative, just like last week at Nashville, okay? And for Jet Lawrence to get the start, I think it's pretty much clear that we're going to see Jet Lawrence as the Supercross titleist this year, unless Jet does something really dumb. And I don't see that happening, really. But I still think that when if Jet Lawrence wins this title, he's going to have a lot more merit than Ryan Dungey did in 2010. And you can see my video then on that. So, you know, with Jet Lawrence winning, I hope that he wins that title because it'll be meaning a lot more because all the competition's out there. But if you're Cooper Webb, that was the last kind of race that you wanted to have. Because Cooper Webb, he finished in fourth after losing third to Jason Anderson on the last lap. And props to Webb for sending it. Unfortunately, he ended up on the ground. But that's not what you wanted after erasing Jet Lawrence's 21-point lead. But for Jet, I think that win was a clutch win, kind of like what Jeff Emig did when he won his title in 1997, when he won the Dallas race in the mud. And Jeremy McGrath had to come from last to fourth. And who knows? We could see history repeat itself. Dungey won the 450 title as a rookie in 2010 and then went on to three more additional titles. Jet Lawrence, we could be seeing another Chad Reed in the making, only this time I think Jet could be winning a lot more than Chad Reed did. But still, I still consider Chad Reed one of the true GOAT after Carmichael and McGrath, mainly because he knew when to walk away and he knew that he was still competitive. And some people are saying, Stewart's the GOAT. I don't believe that for 2 seconds. You want to know why? Because his career did not last as long as Chad Reed's did. Okay? And of course, you could also own up. Of course, you could also kind of throw in the fact that Stewart had tested positive for a banned substance, and that pretty much ruined his career. True. But still, when you look at how Chad Reed's career turned out, although he evaded a drug test himself, you could also say that Reed got better than Stewart because he returned to the motocross season. And then he started getting in the fray while Stewart went supercross only at the prime of his career and kind of killed it in a sense. Okay? So that's why I still say that Chad Reed is still the true GOAT after RC and MC. So many times. I don't care what people say. That's my take. So really. But still, I've regained my respect for Stewart even after he had that 2.5 year hide-and-seek game, as I call it. But still, anyway, as far as Philly's concerned, Jet Lawrence regains control. Chase Sexton was probably the biggest surprise to me after that bad crash at Nashville, where it was reported that a rock had stuck the throttle housing or something like that. And he ended up going down hard. And Chase Sexton, I'd have put him for maybe fourth or fifth at best, but he ended up charging all the way up to second place. And at one point on the Rocky Mountain Fantasy site, I had the first 5 guys all picked out in that exact order. But unfortunately, after Sexton got around Eli Tomac, that pretty much kind of ruined me a little bit. But as far as Eli Tomac goes, I don't think that he was really riding up to what he thinks he should be riding, to the level that he thinks he should be riding at. Because after Sexton got around him, that kind of ruined him. And as a result, Telmac would end up falling to fifth. And we saw the same thing happen to Telmac at Detroit. And I don't think that it was something with the bike. I think it was all on Eli Telmac's ability. Because he didn't really look himself out there. And obviously with a fifth place finish, that kind of backs up what I said. Because he was right there with Jet Lawrence. But after that, he kind of let Lawrence get away. Which kind of disappointed me a little bit. That's kind of why I feel like Eli Telmac is kind of like the king of false senses of hope. So, I don't know. We got two rounds remaining. Is Telmac going to win one before the year's done? I don't know. Is Sexton going to win another before the year's done? I hope so, because he's been showing me stuff as of late. And I think that crash last week at Nashville could have put a monkey wrench in his late season surge. But so far, it doesn't look that way. And is Cooper Webb going to upset Jet Lawrence? I don't see it happening. I think Jet has regained control mentally and physically. And if what I saw at Philly and if what you guys saw at Philly was any indication, I don't think Jet Lawrence could be losing this points lead anytime soon. And he could do what Dungy did in 2010. So two rounds remaining. Unfortunately, I won't be watching Denver live because I got UH softball, their final homestand on Friday and Saturday. You will see a recap video or videos then. It is senior night. 9-9 Rainbow Wahine will bid aloha to Rainbow Wahine Softball Stadium and the University of Hawaii. So hopefully that'll be a three-game sweep for them, but it's going to be tough. Fullerton's a tough team. They're at the top of the stack. So hopefully we'll get at least one or two wins there. So as far as Supercross goes, we head to Denver next and hope that will be a good race. That's Eli Telmac country. And we all know what happened there last year. It looked like Eli Telmac was going to win the title. Boom. He ruptured his Achilles. And that was it for his season. Chase Sexton ended up winning the title. So anyway, guys, that's all for today. And remember, subscribe, and we'll see you all for Denver.